Hello everybody, Alex here. Welcome to my Finance and Accounting Education channel. Today we are going to talk about 21 money rules, basically principles to guide yourself in life, from a Harvard professor named Lawrence J. Kotlikoff. It's actually a very interesting article I found on CNBC.com. And we will also see, which is from my point of view very interesting, how his, let's say, social status, that he's a professor, and also his age, because he's not very, very young, is affecting these money rules or these advices from him. And interesting enough, I also found one piece of advice that somehow contradicts his profile, and we will see exactly which one. But before we jump right in, I'm going to ask you to subscribe to my channel, to hit the bell notification button, and you will never miss an update on my side. I do them quite regularly these days. You should expect new and hopefully interesting videos from me on Tuesdays, Thursdays and Sundays as well. So going directly in, we have 21 money rules from a Harvard professor, Lawrence J. Kotlikoff. Just as I have said, it's an article from CNBC. If you are looking, he doesn't look very young. Since we are not doing like a biography for him, I haven't really researched his birth date, but he took his PhD in 1977, so we can assume that he's not 30 years old. We all want money, some of us dangerously so. Therefore, there are simple and powerful ways to get rich without gambling your hard-earned savings. For sure, they won't all just stick in your brain, and many may change over time as Uncle Sam reforms our taxes and benefits, and as new and better financial products come on board. Still, having guiding principles at hand can help you manage your money and achieve financial security. As an economist, here are the top 21 money rules that I live by and teach. Don't borrow from college for college. It's far too risky and expensive. I don't say that this lightly. I'm a college professor, but you can get a fine education without mortgaging your future and potentially dashing your career plans. It simply involves pursuing scholarships and applying to less expensive, if generally less prestigious institutions. So I wholeheartedly agree with pursuing scholarships. I agree that it's a personal effort. So if you go to a less expensive, less prestigious university, and you can still learn that very well. However, I'm not aware of how large is the gap between the entry level, so the pay gap between the entry level jobs for people with university degrees and people without university degrees in US. So if the gap is very large, it might be reasonable to borrow for college. Actually, I'm linking right now a video called How to Get Rid of Debt. In that video that I did a long time ago, actually, I was listing the reasons for which you can get into debt, and on the green side, meaning that good reasons, besides the fact that besides taking debt for launching your own job, I also listed borrowing for studies, because you are investing in yourself. So it's not for me that easy to say this is 100% a very good advice. That's why on my list I put it neither with a yay nor a nay. Also consider yourself as a person. If you can have a day job and then the evening study, for example on Coursera you get university, so colleges, courses from universities, and if you know you can do that, of course you can do it. But let's just be honest, most of us will end up on Netflix in the evenings and not really studying. Also, you might not know exactly what to study, although you can follow the curricula from universities. You don't have access to maybe that many clarifications from a university teacher. And most importantly, because it's not formal and you don't have deadlines for exams and so on and so forth, this entire process of learning by yourself can derail. So let's just say that I put borrowing for college or for any type of education as a green situation in it, which, or a good situation in which you can get into debt. I listed also yellowish, like mortgage actually, which also contradicts one of the rules of this professor, because I said that it depends when you are doing it, and also it depends on the market conditions. And also on yellowish I put the emergency situation in which you are borrowing because you should have a reserve fund, but still emergencies happen and maybe the reserve fund is not enough and so on and so forth. And totally red type of borrowing, I said that borrowing for lavish gifts, for traveling, for expensive home appliances and electronics, for renovating your house. So basically when you are doing the decoration part, not the necessary renovations, and so on and so forth. This is not a very good idea to get into debt for something like that. Then the second thing is, if your parents are borrowing for your tuition, discuss who will repay. I also agree with this one. I mean, it's common ground. Maybe the parents can get lower interest rates because maybe they own a home and they can get something like a home equity loan. And consider whether they're blowing your inheritance or sacrificing their welfare by helping you attend an affordable college. Then he's saying, strive to own your home, not rent, and try to buy in cash. I don't agree with this. This is particularly the case if you are a moderate to high earner. Having more of your money packed in your home is a way to shelter it from federal and state asset income taxation. So this might be the case in the United States. For example, I live in Austria. Here you have the ratio between rent and average or median home or apartment price. It's being covered in 44 years, which is roughly a 2.72%, which makes renting totally a good idea instead of owning a home. And also this discussion about buying it in cash or with the mortgage is way too more complicated than this. So actually for strive to own your home, not rent, and try to buy it in cash, I said no. It's not written in stone that it's a very good idea in all the conditions. Then mortgages are tax and financial losers, pay them off ASAP. Also I said no to this. It's clear that he's biased because of his age, because he's comparing a mortgage, so 100 debt with a 3.2% interest rate on a mortgage with a bond earning 1.5%. We all know that there are better investment opportunities right now in the market, and for several years it's been going on like this. You can invest in an exchange traded fund or in an index fund, which is a very nice, let's say, compromise between risk and reward, and it will definitely deliver you more than 1.5% and most likely also more than 3.2% the cost of your mortgage. So this idea that you should absolutely pay your mortgage immediately. Also, there is a very complex discussion here. Most of the people don't have money set on site and invested so that they can pay the mortgage with cash, or yeah, instead of having a mortgage, paying it for their homes with cash. So they either have the mortgage but then no investments or no savings, or they have the investments and savings and no mortgage. The idea is that once the conditions in the market change, you can decide to pay immediately your mortgage if you have the money on the side, or you can decide to no longer route the money towards investment but towards earlier or faster repayment of your mortgage. So this absolute that you should pay them off ASAP no matter what are the market conditions, I don't really like this rule. Then owning a home can reduce longevity risk. Here's another reason it's better to own instead of rent. Let's say you're 70 and have found your dream location. Renting for the rest of your life runs the risk of rent hikes without the possibility of your fixed income increasing. In contrast, if you own your home, home prices can soar or collapse, but you'll be insulated. Since you are neither buying nor selling your home, who cares what the housing market does? Your housing consumption is guaranteed through the end of the days. Well, it's also taking into consideration that you are unable to maintain your investments and to gain from them. And the idea is that once you see that's not really working, also when you are 70, you can decide to buy a house. So I said to this one neither yay nor nay, because I can understand that when you are 70 it might be better to own a home. I also when investing in real estate, I also said that if you start investing when you are very, very young and you get to own your home when you are older, you save the rent and you are done with the mortgage. Basically, your investment is starting to pay off. However, if we are talking about longevity risk, do consider that if you are in not a very good shape to live by yourself in your home, it's better to go in an institution where you can get help and medical help, and you can be with the people of your own age. So this also this absolute owning a home can reduce longevity risk, although it's with a can as well. I said neither yes or no to this one as well. Your perfect home may be cheaper several time zones away. This also seems the approach of somebody who's retired, or it may be some place with no state income tax, no state estate tax, and no state inheritance tax. Yes, things are more complicated. Land values in New Hampshire might be higher in light of the state's tax advantage, and the school system may be better in Massachusetts. But who knows? You may be childless and happy to live in a tall 5-decker with no yard. The story is that usually you will be in somewhere where you find a good paying job, and you won't be able to just abandon your job to move somewhere else because the because the property is cheaper in some other state. Yeah, so this kind of decision making you really don't do in your life. That's why to this one I said that actually no, I don't agree with it. Choose jobs that even everyone but you hates. Yes and no. Here you also see the bias, because he's a university professor. He's ignoring the fact that not everybody has a college degree, and sometimes you don't choose your job, the job chooses you, and you don't have that many options if you're not very well educated. And yes, it can be that the job can pay well, but there are jobs like dishwashing, cleaning jobs, toilet cleaning jobs that everyone hates and nobody wants, but they are also not guaranteed to pay you more. So be careful with these absolutizations. Don't worry about career and job hopping. Actually do. This is the one that I said that it's going against his profile, because being a teacher and working for a university means that he got some kind of stability in his career, so he didn't really change that many jobs in the private sector, probably. I'm making a lot of assumptions. I hope I'm not wrong. As being equal, skills, education, oh, that one we read already. How can you not shop around where there are so many options? Certainly the fastest path to a raise is getting a credible outside offer. Yes, maybe you will get a raise, but for the career, so for the real and important career steps, that so a promotion is better to be around for a longer time in a company. In from my experience, you will be surprised how many people that are not really qualified for that specific position are getting promoted just because they are around, and the companies cannot wait for years till some candidate that is fit for this position is showing and is applying for that job. And people that stay within the company somehow, cover for maybe some gaps in skills with the fact that they are reliable and they get promoted. So you can do some changes maybe when you are young in your early career, but later if you keep doing them very often just for these raises, it might be not that beneficial for you. Then consider working for yourself. Of course, this is always a good advice. If you have some business idea and you can want to have a startup or even several business ideas, I wholeheartedly support that. Keep thinking about tomorrow. Of course, it's always a good idea. Are you in the best possible career for the rest of your working day? Should you make a switch? Is your current job in danger? Set a date every few months to do a career review with a spouse, partner or friend. You can do it by yourself. The way I play this is that, and also related with choose a job that everyone but you hates is that I chose my job of choosing was working with numbers that not many people like, and also a job that I don't think it will go away that easily, being an accountant. Your living standard is your bottom line, of course. The higher your living standard, the less available money you will have for saving and investment. We already know this, and it might be that you don't really need to have such a high living standard. So I also agreed with this one. Then it's a very interesting one. Marriage beats long partnering long term. Thinking about this in terms of fiscal or financial benefits, I didn't know what to say, so I said neither yay nor nay. If you do get married, count on getting divorced. To this one I said yes, but this is like a no-brainer, meaning that it's like telling somebody that's taking a walk outside every day that some days it might be rainy outside. Yeah, it's not really that great of a piece of advice. All lifestyle decisions, switching careers, moving homes. So let's say that these two you can somehow decide or think of the price or the financial consequences better and be more objective about them. But about getting married, having kids and getting divorced, let's say that there are other factors which should come into play and not really the financial cost of these decisions. So I said definitely nay to this one. Then use retirement account contributions, conversions and withdrawals to cut your lifetime taxes. Make sure to contribute enough to get your employer's match. This is very specific to the United States, and I, of course, even though I live in Europe, I said yes. In Europe we don't have 401(k)s, but it makes sense to do it if your contribution gets matched, so doubled. Then wait until age 70 to take Social Security benefits. Retirees who wait to claim can get hundreds of dollars more each month than those who take benefits early. Well, what if you die when you are 68 and you never know if you are going to live till 75 or till 90 years old? Of course, this isn't feasible for everyone, but there's my plea. Before making any moves, figure out a strategy that maximizes your household total lifetime benefits. Yeah, the problem is that you don't know the lifetime. Exactly, and also you, it might be that you need the money, so it's not a decision which can be that coldly made. Yeah, thinking of this total lifetime benefits, you may be needing the money, and this is why I said that waiting until 70 is not a stone written rule from my point of view, so I said nay to this. If you don't formally request your Social Security benefits, you won't get it. I said yes, of course. It's applicable not only to the United States, it's also in Europe. If you don't file for a pension, you won't get a pension. The authorities don't know that you need a pension or you want a pension, and so on and so forth. The Social Security Administration's program operations manual system has thousands of rules which its staff can get wrong in part or in full. I said also yes, and also for Europe it's good to check if you have all the employment periods in your pension file with the right salaries and so on and so forth, so do some sort of checkup. Retiring early is financial suicide. I said definitely no to this, because it depends on how much you have saved and invested before, how wealthy you are first, and then if you would take it as absolutely as that, you will never retire, because you are always after retirement making less money than before retirement. Or it might not be that case, maybe you are forced into retirement, you got fired 1-2 years and you cannot find another job, so you are somehow forced into an earlier retirement, let's say. Or it can be because of your medical condition. So it's not only there are not only the financial factors which need to be taken here into consideration, and yeah, it's something like saying it's better to make more money than to make less money. Yeah, it's not very helpful. Most conventional investment advice is to be nice, of dubious value. Let's just say that also these 21 rules are not Some of them are also of dubious value, just as we have spoken about. If you're worried about downside risk, play the stock market like a casino. Well, yeah, if you are that risk adverse, you can just put some money on the stock market, then make some gains, and then withdraw your initial capital and just play with the ulterior gains, and that's it if you are that risk adverse. So when counting the yeas or nays, I got to 14 yeas and 11 nays. And from my point of view, this is not very conclusive. You've seen that there are many things. Also, some of them are contradicting, because, for example, he's saying that keep thinking about tomorrow. Then he's in some advices is like, don't. So for example, owning a home can reduce longevity risk. Yeah, but that means that you want to be secured and not worry about tomorrow, so not think about tomorrow anymore when you are at pension. So let's say that not all of them apply. And what's missing also from the article, because it's limited in space in how many characters he has there or he can write there, maybe he has more arguments for these options, but they are missing, and the things are not always black and white about these things. You cannot definitely say that a mortgage is better than paying your house in full ASAP, or paying your house in full ASAP is always better than the mortgage conditions apply, also on which continent you live, and yeah, so it's not that easy. If you like this video, hit the like button. If you would like to comment, you have something to add about it, please do it in the comment section. Also share it with somebody that might be interested about it. And most importantly, do not forget to subscribe to my channel, to hit the bell notification button, and you will never miss an update on my side. I do them quite regularly these days, on Tuesdays, Thursdays and Sundays. You should expect new and hopefully very interesting videos from me. Below this video, you have some other opportunities or ways through which you can support me. You can create an eToro account and trade there without a commission or a fee, which is always a saving no matter how often you are trading. And also an Amazon wish list with hardware and software items, which can help me improve the quality of these videos, being also beneficial for you. But let's just say that from financial perspective, this is the most inconvenient for you. The easiest way to support me is to subscribe to my channel, to hit the bell notification button, and of course to continue to watch my videos. Once again, my name is Alex Petrescu. This is my finance and accounting education channel here on YouTube. I thank you for your time and patience today, and I look forward to presenting to you with the next opportunity. Goodbye.